Recent studies in the field of social sciences across the globe consistently demonstrates the crucial role that a mother plays within the well-being of her children and family. Specialists in parenting highlight how mother's parenting, relationship status, and stability, along with her own well-being, are correlated with the welfare of her family. The main argument that revolves around this topic is that how do mothers in the 21st century become a positive role model within the lives of her children? Many parents wonder what has gone wrong that their children are acting in a certain way, or argue that today's generation have gone wild or out of control. Is it the parents' fault or is it the children's? Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the third episode of Fatima the Great with me, your host Ahmed Ali. Now, Sayyid Hussein Al-Qazwini is joining us tonight to discuss the role of mothers within the lives and within a family, while linking to today's topic, which is Fatima the mother. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaikum assalam.
How are you?
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen.
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Now, Sayyidina, yesterday's topic and today's topic, they are linked in a way where it takes a wise decision. A person should choose wisely for the opposite gender, for the spouse that they are planning to live with for the rest of their lives. And if the only victims within a bad marriage are who?
The children.
And that's what we are trying to focus on today, is that choosing the right person, which we talked about yesterday, and linking it to how to be a good parent, especially a good mother. Now, before getting into solutions, I would like you to touch upon how did Fatima al-Zahra raise her children?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته To you, my dear host, and to my dear brothers and sisters who are watching us tonight. فاطمة الزهراء عليه السلام was definitely the greatest mother in history. Proof of this is not just we're not just making big claims. Proof of this is her children.
Mm-hmm.
You judge a mother by her children, just like you judge an author by his book. You judge an engineer by what he creates. You judge an architect by what he makes. You judge a mother by her children. We can say a lot about Hind through her son Muawiyah.
Yes.
A son like Muawiyah, just by looking at him, we can say a lot about his mother. Of course, I don't mean that every evil person, his mother has to be evil. No.
Yes.
This is not what I'm trying to say. Otherwise, for example, Qabil, the son of Adam, was evil.
Yes.
Does that make his father and mother evil? No. Mm. Sometimes the parents do all that they can for the child, but it's the problem with the child, not with the parents.
But we have Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr.
Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr is a different case because his father died when he was young. He was an orphan.
Mm-hmm.
Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr was raised by Imam Ali alayhi salam, not by his father.
Yes.
So, you know, the credit goes to Imam Ali.
Yes.
Not to Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr died and Muhammad was at a very young age. Anyhow, when we look at Imam al-Hassan and Imam al-Hussein and Sayyida Zainab and Umm Kulthum, you have to say that what a great mother they had.
Yes.
You know the quote that we talked about, was it yesterday or the day before in the past episode or before, that children will follow your example. They will not follow your advice.
That's yesterday's episode.
That's the technique that Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam used.
Yes.
Fatima al-Zahra did not need to advise her children. They followed by example. Yes. For example, we have narrations that say during the last 10 nights of Ramadan, which are very special nights. And some narrations say that Laylatul Qadr is one of the last final 10 nights, meaning from the eve of the 20th till the eve of the 30th,
yes,
or Laylatul Eid. The last 10 nights are extremely special. They should be devoted to worshipping and praying and supplicating. Narrations tell us that Fatima al-Zahra would gather the beds. Of course, back then they didn't have beds like we do that are, you know, that are set. No one moves them. No, their bed was a piece of cloth put on the floor where they'd sleep on, a mattress or whatever. And then once they wake up in the morning, they'd remove it.
Yeah.
They'd collect it. During those 10 nights, there were no beds in the house of Ahlul Bayt. Fatima al-Zahra would gather the beds for 10 nights. That means there is no sleep during those 10 nights. There were only naps. A nap here, a nap there. Just like students during days of exams.
Yes.
There's no sleeping.
Yeah.
There's taking naps. You take a nap whenever you can. After an exam, you know, once you come back from a library, so on and so forth. As you could tell, I remember some of the college days.
During the exam.
Some people sleep during the exam. That's how it was. Fatima al-Zahra taught them from a young age that during those 10 nights, there's no sleeping. You learned. You learned by example.
Yes.
You know, it's not enough to tell your child, don't sleep, but you go and sleep. Children learn by example, by actions. They learn from actions, not by words. That's why the famous saying says, actions speak louder than words.
Yes.
In another case, another scene from the life of Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam, history tells us that once, there's a narration that says that once Imam al-Hassan woke up in the middle of the night and he saw his mother praying Salat al-Layl, Fatima al-Zahra, and in such a humble state, with so much concentration, praying Salat al-Layl, and she was in Salat al-Watr, the final prayer in Salat al-Layl, in which there's a long qunut.
Yes.
He says, I woke up in the middle of the night and I heard my mother Fatima praying. Praying for what? Praying for people, believers. Oh Allah, forgive this person. Oh Allah, forgive that person.
Wow.
Oh Allah, give this person health, that person rizq. She was praying for others. He says, I waited for her to stop praying for herself. You know, usually you and I and everyone else, when we pray, we only pray for ourselves. Oh Allah, give me this, give me that. We don't pray for others. If we do, very quickly, and only for the closest people of us, our parents. Fatima al-Zahra prayed for everyone except herself. So Imam al-Hassan was astonished. Imam al-Hassan was a child, but this caught his attention. When she finished, he said, my mother Fatima, you prayed for everyone in your salah, but you didn't pray for yourself. She said, Bunay, al-jar thumma al-dar. This is a famous Arabic quote.
Yes.
Your neighbor, you think of your neighbor first, and then of your own house. Think of your neighbor's house first, and then yourself. Fatima al-Zahra was teaching them through actions, not through words.
Yes.
Selflessness. Not just thinking of yourself. Thinking of others, putting others before, thinking of others before you think of yourself. This is rare, especially in dua. You know, there's some people that are greedy with their wealth and money.
Mm-hmm.
There's some people that are greedy with their dua.
Yes.
They're greedy with their dua. They're not willing to recite dua for anyone else. Even though we have narrations that say if a believer, if a mu'min, prays for 40 people, he mentions their name, and their names, and he prays for them. Allah will tell him, وَلَكَ مِثْلُهُ. You will have that which you prayed for them. You prayed for their health, their wealth, their rizq, their forgiveness. Whatever you prayed for them, you shall have. Without asking for yourself, Allah will say, whatever you prayed for them, it will be for you as well. Fatima al-Zahra taught through actions. In the famous story of ويطعمون الطعام على حبه مسكينا ويتيما وأسيرا. الحسن والحسين were children. They were fasting for 3 days. In the famous story of the Nadr, Al-Hasan al-Hussein were ill, and Amir al-Mu'mineen and Fatima al-Zahra made a Nidr, or Nadr, that if they become well, we will fast for 3 days. And indeed, they were well, they fasted for 3 days. At the time of Iftar, when they came and they knocked at the door, and Fatima al-Zahra collected the loaves of bread, you know, this act that we've mentioned.
Yes.
And we mentioned in our lectures and our, if we analyze it a little bit, it has so many meanings. One, it means generosity. Yes. It shows the generosity of Fatima al-Zahra and her household. It shows sense of, you know, selflessness, sense of sacrifice, patience, so on and so forth. But one of the meanings is that Fatima al-Zahra was showing her children by actions. She didn't need to come and give them a lecture that, my dear sons, if you're ever faced, you know, if you ever come across such a situation in which a beggar, a prisoner, an orphan asks you, give them. No, she didn't need to teach them, advise them. She showed them. Do you know how powerful that was?
Yes.
It's so powerful. It's so powerful on the psyche, on the mentality, on the upbringing of their children. Not just her, but Imam Ali as well. But because we've designated this the session on Fatima al-Zahra as a mother, this was one of her main techniques. She taught through example, not by words, not by advice.
And actually, it's unfortunate that we kind of see the opposite of how parents raise their children today. I mean, I've seen this personally. I've heard it from other parents talking to their children, where they tell them, you know, don't care about anyone else, care about yourself. Try to succeed. Everyone will do their best to succeed. You know, just focus on your own thing. Well, I mean, if we really call ourselves followers of Ahl Bayt alayhim as-salam, I mean, for 3 consecutive days, the Ahl Bayt broke their fast with something less than little.
With water.
Close to nothing. Yet, you know, as you said, it promotes generosity, selflessness. And really, we actually need that. You know, not to the extent, you know, in Ramadan or when we fast, it's a special occasion where everything is, you know, put on the table. But yet, you know, having such little, we rarely see such a huge donation for someone that has little, you know what I mean? But according to a recent study conducted in 2014, reveals that 74% of women finding parenting more challenging in modern times. Some of the main challenges facing parents, especially mothers, as they state, is finding enough time in the day and balancing motherhood and career. Effectively disciplining children, allowing children to develop independence in a dangerous world, and with the divorce rates, you know, skyrocketing, as we see in the West, similar in the East, being a single parent is extremely hard to get help and support. I mean, through this, it's evident that parenting, especially for mothers, it's a huge responsibility. It's a huge challenge. What kind of evidence, what kind of advice do mothers need in raising their children?
Once I was visiting a community, and I noticed a couple. And then it turned out to be couples, not one couple, where both, you know, both spouses, the husband and the wife, they went to work. They were both doctors. They both went to work from 8 in the morning. They would come back at 5 in the evening. Now, that's fine. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
But the problem was they had a child, maybe a year and a half. Child. This child was taken to the
daycare
from before 8 in the morning.
Oh.
And they would receive the child at around 6 p.m. And as soon as the child would come back home, he would eat something and they would put his head to sleep. They would put him to sleep, wake up in the morning, and the same routine.
Same routine.
So on and so every day. It's the same schedule. Just like they would go to work, he would go to the daycare.
Yeah.
He would go to his work. They'd come back in the evening, have a small meal, put him to sleep, and they'd go. They'd go to sleep, and then same thing would happen every day.
Yeah.
Now, I don't want to say that what the couple was doing is haram. No, it's not necessarily haram. But just because something is not haram, it doesn't mean that we should do it.
Mm-hmm.
This child wasn't seeing his mother nor his father. Some might say, well, do you mean that the mother should stay at home? I say, no. It's both the mother and the father's responsibility to take care of the child.
Yeah.
But imagine this, having the child spend all of his day in the daycare and then come back and sleep and never see his parents, never see love from his parents,
yes,
never see emotions. The child is a year and a half, but that child will grow. Will become two, three, four, five. When will this child begin to learn?
At that age, it's very crucial for the parents to be there with the child.
Absolutely. The child is being put at a daycare. God knows what they're feeding him. You know, this haram food, it has an effect on a person.
Definitely.
Even from young age.
Definitely.
From a young age, the child is being given food. God knows what kind of food it is, right? He's not receiving the love and emotions that he should be from his parents. A babysitter will feed the child, change his diapers, clean him, and so on. But the babysitter doesn't give him love and emotions that he needs.
Mm-hmm.
And so on and so forth. Who will teach him how to pray, how to fast? Who will teach him that this is good, this is wrong, this is evil? Unfortunately, in the West, this is something very common.
Mm-hmm.
Either to have a babysitter come at home and take care of the child, or to take the child to
daycare.
A daycare. This is a major problem in the West.
Now, is this decision, will this decision have a positive impact, or would it negatively influence the child, daycare and babysitting?
You know, everything should have limits. Everything should have limits. I am not saying that parents should not have babysitters whatsoever and should not send their children to daycare whatsoever. If it's a couple of hours a day, 2 hours, 3 hours,
mm-hmm.
that's realistic. That's something real. That's something fine. You have to have a babysitter once in a while.
Mm-hmm.
Parents have to attend the session. They want to go out, enjoy themselves, relax. Once in a while, you know, an hour or two a day with a babysitter, it won't do damage. But to spend 10 hours,
yeah.
7 hours, 6 hours, half the day with a babysitter or in daycare, this could be damaging. This could be damaging to the psyche of the child and to the psychology of the child.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of parents, a lot of females, they ask, what should I do? Should I stay at home and be a mother, or should I go out and work? I think there's no contradiction. It's not either or. You either have to be a housewife, or you work and not be a housewife. No, I think women could divide their time. They could divide their time into volunteering or into working, and they divide some of their time to their child. It's doable. It's doable. But to neglect the child whatsoever, this will have negative consequences.
Of course.
The easiest consequence is that they lose the language. They forget the language, their native tongue, Arabic, Farsi, Urdu, whatever it is. You know, children learn from a young age how to pray when they see their children and when they see their parents pray at home. When they see the recitation of the Quran, when they hear the sound of the Adhan at a young age, it goes into their mind.
Yes.
It affects them.
Of course.
You don't have to persuade your child and beg them to pray if they've seen prayers at home all the time. If they've heard the sound of the Adhan and Quran all the time, you don't need to beg them to recite Quran.
Yeah.
They begin to become fond of Adhan and Quran and these things. It starts early. It starts early.
It does. I mean, and especially with you know, what's going on in the media and, you know, everything, the mentality of the youth, even the babysitter, you can't really, you know, rely on someone that
has, you know, babysitting as a job. I mean, a lot of people do rely on that, and you know, they have a degree now for a babysitter. They go into courses and so on and so forth. But really, the mentality of the individual will influence the child. But inshallah, we'll continue this, but after a short break. So, respected viewers, do stay tuned, for we'll go into a short break and come back to you shortly. Sisters in Islam, once again, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the second part of tonight's episode, where we discuss the crucial role that a mother plays within a family and the well-being of her children. This was discussed with my dear guest and honorable guest, Sayyid Hussein Al-Qazwini. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Assalamu alaikum.
Once again, I welcome you to our show.
Thank you very much.
Allah islamkum. Now, before the break, we touched upon a few points on some advices and some of the things that parents need to do and should do, extracting lessons from the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, specifically from Fatimah al-Zahra, peace and blessings be upon her. Now, in the beginning, I mentioned something where it's known right now. Parents wonder what is going on with the actions, with the behavior of their children, in a way where they can't control the child, they can't monitor, and if they do, they'll lose their child. Some kids tend to run away from their parents because of their, you know, exaggerative monitor on the child from the parents. So we find that a lot of mistakes are committed by the parents and by the children. Can you mention a few?
Sure. I see from a lot of parents that they're religious and they want religious children. They want their children to be raised in a religious way. They want to teach their children what is halal, what is haram. One of the common mistakes is that parents, all they do is, this is halal, this is haram, that is wajib. Do this because this is wajib, and don't do that because that is haram. Tayyib, that's good. I understand that you want your children to do their religious obligations and avoid what is forbidden. But children have inquisitive minds.
Yes.
Just to tell them that this is haram, that's not convincing. Well, haram. But why? Yeah. But why? Why is music haram?
Everything that is forbidden is most likely be.
Yeah. It's, you know, when kids, when you tell them, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this, will actually get them curious to know, why can't I do it? Let me do it.
Yeah.
Let me see what will happen if I do it. My advice to parents is that when you tell them do this or don't do that, give them a justification. Give them a reason. We tell our children, don't listen to music. If they have their iPads on, they're watching a game or a show or whatever, there's music, we tell them to lower the sound. Okay, that's good. But why?
Why?
Explain to them.
Yes.
Explain to them what music does, how it affects their mind, how it gets them to, you know, it pollutes the mind. Just like Quran cleanses the mind and the soul, music comes in and does exactly the opposite. It pollutes the mind. Especially today's music.
Oh.
Especially today's music that's full of rubbish, it's full of foul language, it's all about, especially, you know,
Western music, hip-hop. And
yeah, hip-hop and all that. It's about, you know, a lot of it involves drugs and gangs and violence.
Sexuality.
And, sexuality. We're polluting.
Yeah.
We're polluting the mind of the child by allowing him to listen. So explain to them.
Yeah.
Explain to them, why is this haram? Pork. Well, don't eat pork. Well, but why? Why? Yeah. If a child doesn't understand why, you might go and do it behind your back.
Yes.
Because he hasn't been convinced.
A lot of children tend
they'll to get out of school as long as parents are not watching. Yeah. They'll go to McDonald's and they'll
say
go the whole
and
say Bismillah. And explain to them. Tell them that, for example,
yes,
pigs, they eat feces. It's a dirty animal. Unlike sheep, unlike other animals that eat healthy,
mm-hmm.
Pigs eat feces. Maybe that is the reason why
some
they
may
become.
Disagree. Some may keep them in a farm where they don't.
For example,
like scientifically, pigs are proven to have a messed up mind. Although they don't have a mentality to think of what they're doing.
Right.
But if anyone, if the dear viewers can go refer to what is wrong, scientifically wrong with eating pig or pork,
yeah,
then they'll understand why.
Right. Right. And it's been proven that pork meat, is the healthiest.
Yes.
It's full of cholesterol. It's full of grease.
It's full of fat.
If we compare it to other forms of meat. You have to pray. Well, why? A child will not understand. You have to explain it to
them. Yes.
This is a common mistake, that we tell our children what to do without giving them justifications and reasons. They're not going to be convinced. But when you really convince them, you tell them this is the reason, they'll never forget. They'll never forget it. They'll grow up with that justification and reasoning. When they grow up, they'll want to research more.
Yes.
And they'll give the same justifications to their children,
yeah,
and so on and so forth.
You're nurturing a knowledgeable child.
Absolutely. So this is one common mistake. Another common mistake is that I've seen parents on two extremes. I've seen parents that are completely lenient.
Yeah.
They let their children do whatever they want, stay up as long as they want, speak to whoever they want, play on their iPads as long as they want, go on whatever channels that they want, listen to whatever, watch whatever, eat whatever.
Come back.
Absolutely no restrictions.
Yeah.
No restrictions whatsoever. Why? Because they say it's a poor child. I don't want my child to hate me. I want my child to love me. And on the other hand, you have some parents that are dictators.
Yeah.
That all they don't know other than to say no. It's always no. Can I do this? No. Can I do that? No, no, no. These are two extremes. Being too lenient is destructive. There has to be restrictions.
Yes.
You can't allow your children to watch whatever they want and listen to whatever they want and play with whatever they want and have whatever they want. No, this spoiling of the child is destructive to the child. The child has to learn that there are limits,
mm-hmm,
that there are red lines, that they can't have whatever they want.
So
there are certain things that they cannot have.
So spoiling the child is bad?
To some degree, to some limits. Yeah, spoiling them when they're small, to some limits, it's fine. But to let them have whatever they want, no. It's like going shopping with a child and whatever the child sees,
they want. Yeah.
That's going to be damaging to the child and to you, because number one, they'll finish everything in your pocket. They'll finish all your money. Two, the child will grow up thinking that whatever they want, they should have.
Yeah.
Well, one day you're not going to be there. The parents are not going to be there. When this child grows up with the childlike mentality that everything they want, they should have, that's going to be destructive. Now, when it comes to religious things, the child has to learn as well that there are limits. For example, they shouldn't play with their iPads all the time. There's some children, as soon as they come back from school, until they sleep, they're on their iPads. This is wrong. This is a mistake. There should be hours. An hour a day. 2 hours a day. The rest should be spent either on homework, or exercise, or playing. Today, kids don't play any longer. They don't go outside and play.
Play online.
They're always online. They're always on. They play with their iPads. They don't play outside.
Yeah.
And this is very destructive. And children have energy. They don't take out their energy outside. They're always on their iPads. What happens is they engage in fights with their siblings, with their cousins, with their neighbors. The energy comes out in fights. This is a problem. That we don't say no to the child. This is one. And on the other extreme, is the parents that always say no. This is also a problem.
Yes.
You can't always say no to your child.
Huge problem.
There's nothing wrong with, you know, once in a while, let them play. Let them eat. Let them enjoy themselves. They want to go somewhere, take them. They want to go to a restaurant, take them. Don't always say no. Saying no all the time, that's also, that will develop in a child, you know, the sense that my parents are dictators. My mother is a dictator. My father is a dictator. And they'll go and sneak behind your back and do the things that they want to do.
Yes. Is that haram? Is that forbidden? Yani, for example, some parents, as an example, some parents, when, you know, the child says, take me to the park, take me to an aquarium, parents say no. If he goes behind their back and goes to the aquarium or whatever, wherever he wants to go, that place is not, you know, nothing haram involved, but yet he goes. Is that action forbidden or is it okay?
No, it's well, if it's a child, if that person is a child, children are not obligated.
A youth. A teenager up to like early adults.
Right. Obedience to parents is advised, but it is not wajib. Yani, if your father says, I want you to go to Najaf right now, you don't have to go to Najaf. But listening to them, not hurting them, is important. Not hurting their feelings.
But I thought it's obligatory to obey your parents.
It's recommended, no. Mm. I mean, your father tells you, eat this. Do you have to eat it? No. It's advised not to hurt them. It's advised not to break their feelings. But do you have to do exactly as they say? No, not especially as you grow older, now that you're a young adult.
If you can clarify that, just in case tonight some problems might occur, God forbid, at some houses where, you know, a parent tells, go to sleep, no. Say, the sense said, you don't have to listen to your parents.
No, as in, is it wajib? As in, if you don't, you will go to hell? No, it's not like that.
Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَخْفَضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذِّلِ. And, you know, be humble towards your parents. And it goes even further where you...
The Quran says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا.
Allah is not, you know, recommending us. He's,
right, he's saying ihsan, show them kindness, show them mercy, kindness, yeah. Be good to them. But do you have to obey every single thing that they... I don't know how we got into this.
Yeah.
But I'm not saying that we should not obey parents, absolutely. Obedience of parents is definitely recommended. But is it haram? If you don't, that's another issue. No. Scholars say that it's not haram. It's not haram.
Hopefully we can have an episode just on that.
On obedience of parents, yes.
On obedience. We did have one earlier in Ramadan.
Yes, I believe so.
We did have one on that, but inshallah we can continue that.
Sure.
But what else?
This is a common mistake, either to be too lenient or to be too harsh. Mm-hmm. No, you have to be, you know, seek a middle ground. Don't take the two extremes. Another common mistake that parents perform with their children is lack of consistency. Lack of consistency. Let me give you an example. You tell your children to pray on a Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, but on Wednesday and Thursday, you don't tell them to pray. That's lack of consistency. You either tell them every day or you don't tell them. But on and off, it depends on whether you're tired or not. That's not right. Parenting should be consistent. Mm-hmm. Or let me give you another example. You tell your children to sleep early at 8 p.m. But three nights out of the week, you let them stay up till 11 p.m. That's not correct. That's not correct. You either let them sleep at 8 p.m. every night or 11 p.m. every night. But to change lack of consistency, some nights you stick to the rules, mm-hmm. And other nights you don't stick to the rules. That's lack of consistency.
Well, you just said that you don't be too lenient and you don't be too rough.
Right.
Middle grounds. Yeah. For example, someone works out, there's cheating days, where, you know, the person was working out, or, you know, correct. gives himself
right.
a break.
Right. I understand. On weekends, you let them stay up till, for example, 10 p.m. I understand that.
Yeah.
But I mean that there should be consistency in parenting. Or, I'll give you another example. You punish your child whenever they say a foul language. For example, if they are allowed to play with their iPads for 2 hours, you reduce it to an hour and a half. They say a foul language again, you reduce it to an hour.
Put a soap in their mouth.
Well, not exactly soap in the mouth. This is worse. Classic, yeah. This is worse.
Yes.
But you have to stick to that rule. So if after 3-4 days they say a foul language, they say a foul word, and you don't punish them, they'll say, well, I got away with it. Yeah. Another time they say, and you didn't punish them, you can't pick and choose when you want to punish. You either punish them all the time or you don't. Because why? Because
you can clarify the meaning of punishment. What do you mean by punishment?
Punishment, I mentioned, as in, for example, reducing the hours of play. Mm-hmm. For example, if they get to watch an hour of TV every day, you make it 45 minutes, make it 30 minutes. That's a punishment. Mm-hmm. That's a punishment. Why you remain consistent? Because when you're not consistent, you will be giving them mixed messages. If you punish them once for saying a foul language, but another time you didn't, the child will say, well, I don't get it. Is using foul language a good thing or a bad thing? Mm-hmm. Because if it's a bad thing, why didn't you punish me twice? If it's a good thing, why did you only punish me once? Why not twice? You see, consistency is something very important in parenting. And it requires patience. Consistency requires patience. The Quran says, وَأْمُرْ أَحْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. Order them to pray and be patient. اصطبر is patience and tolerance. Parenting requires patience and requires consistency. Mm-hmm. This is a common mistake that a lot of parents do. They're not consistent in parenting and disciplining. Sometimes, for example, I've seen some parents, they don't allow their children to drink soft drinks. But they pick and choose. 3 days out of the week, they don't allow them, but 3 days out of the week, they allow. Mm-hmm. Well, where's the consistency in that? The child will get mixed messages. Am I allowed or am I not allowed? You see, there has to be consistency in parenting. When you tell them, do this, don't do that, this is wrong, this is good, there has to be consistency.
Mm-hmm. Now, we talked so much about parents, and some children might get the idea out of this episode, or our youth, that the only fault is the parents' fault. Does the fault also fall on the children's shoulders or not?
Of course, there's some faults on the on children. Children are children.
Well, children, we're saying children right now.
Children love to play. They love to have fun. Children are wild. You know, if you leave a child undisciplined, they'll do whatever they can. They'll do the most amount of damage that they can. I think it's mostly the parents' fault, because a child is a child.
What about teenagers? They're still children.
Huh. Teenagers, well, they're teenagers. We don't call them children anymore. They're teenagers.
They're still children. Technically, if they live under their father, like their parents' roof, and they take orders.
Right.
And, you know, they haven't developed that full maturity yet.
Right. Teenagers, obviously, they can commit mistakes as well. Teenagers they're adolescents. They're no longer children, and nor are they adults. They're somewhere
in between.
They're in between. Teenagers, yes, they can commit mistakes. A common mistake is that, you know, they're told several times not to do this or not to do that, but they continue doing it, knowing that this hurts the parents. I mentioned this yesterday, that, you know, I want all youth to know that tomorrow you'll be parents as well.
Yes.
You will have children of your own. The same way, whatever way you treat your parents today, your children will treat you. Be good to them, your children will be good to you. Be bad to them, this is karma. All religions believe in karma.
Yes.
Not just Muslims. Even people that don't believe in God.
Yeah, believe in karma.
Even
atheists.
Goes
around, comes around.
Even Buddhists who don't formally have, you know, a God. I think.
They do their own way.
In their own way. They believe in karma. A lot of people believe in karma. The way you treat your parents, your children will treat you. Know that. Know that for a fact. Mm-hmm. So, but unfortunately, teenagers, they don't realize that. Mm-hmm. They don't realize that, you know, in a split second, within a couple of years, with a blink of an eye, they'll wake up and they're 30, 40, and they have children of their own, mm-hmm. and the children are giving them a hard time.
A hard time. Now, being a parent, I know you have a child, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep him healthy for
thank
you.
Thank you.
What do you use? How do you raise your child?
That's a good question. One of the techniques, of course, there's a lot of ways, and I know that we don't have a lot of time.
Yes.
But one of the ways, and I find it useful, mm-hmm. is by storytelling. At night, my kids can't fall asleep without a story. So I say, okay, I hit two birds with one stone. They want to hear a story, and I want to teach them. So I teach them through a story, and I see it most effective. Mm-hmm. So for example, if my son refuses to study, he wants to play, I'll put in a story. In the story, the character is a person who doesn't study, that always wants to play, that always has his iPad, and I give the results that he failed in school and he didn't receive gifts from his parents, from the teacher. But on the contrary, he had a friend who would always study, who wouldn't mix, you know, studying with playing. He had hours of studying and hours for playing. And when he passed the exam, his father threw him a party, he bought him a, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
He doesn't realize that I'm speaking about him. He doesn't realize that it's him. Mm-hmm. It's about someone else,
yes.
but he picks up the message. That if I do this, I'll get the same results. If I do that, I'll get that results. Mm-hmm. I find storytelling is very effective. And they don't forget a good story. And you mm-hmm. have to add, you know, you have to dramatize it, and you have to add maybe superheroes in the story, and so on and so forth, to make it interesting.
Yes.
But you put in a message. Mm-hmm. You put in a moral. Look at the Qur'an. The Qur'an is full of stories. More than one-third of the Qur'an is stories. Stories of Prophet Musa, Isa, Ibrahim, our own Prophet. Full of stories.
Five-year-olds, how can they relate to that? I know we have probably 2 minutes, but how can a five-year-old or a six-year-old compare, you know, relate to that?
They relate.
How?
They relate because they love stories. Children really love stories. And if you put in a moral to it, it gets the message to them. I guess I have experience with my 7-year-old and my 5-year-old, even my 4-year-old. Mm-hmm. They love stories.
No, not stories. You just mentioned like the Quran stories. In the
even
Quran.
Quranic stories.
How?
You simplify it.
Yeah, for example, Prophet Moses, who was
right
old, to a 7-year-old.
You simplify the story. For example, you tell them that Nuh alayhi salam, Allah sent him to a group of people that would lie. He would tell his people not to lie. Of course, this is true because mm-hmm. he called them to religion. But you have to simplify it. He would tell them not to use foul language. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and children, these are things that they relate to.
Yes.
He would tell them not to listen to music. But they would. You have to simplify it.
Yes.
It makes complete sense to them. It makes complete sense, and they fall in love with the stories of prophets.
Mm-hmm. I would like to thank you very much for joining us tonight.
My pleasure.
And sharing the experiences of parenting with
my
us.
My pleasure.
Thank you very much once again. Respected viewers, one of the key and one of the most important things that we talked about today is the importance of keeping a parenting mentality and a positive parenting mentality so we can raise a generation, a wise generation, full of knowledge and wisdom. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.